it's got nothing to do with Moscow.
For Moscow, it's okay.
Right?
For Moscow, it's okay.
For Moscow, it's okay. All right, so I'm gonna, first of all, here's a rough plan. It's also like a scheme of my humble understanding of homological neurosymmetry. So here we have some, I'm gonna describe some combinatorial objects. Then now, this is what I understand homological mirror symmetry immediately. And then there is a rectifier here. Well, let's say it's a topological. Topological rectifier. And on the other side, there is this Landau-Ginzburg model. This is A side, this is going to be the B side. And then, that's what people do, so they define some objects, they see them inside here, they see them inside there, and then they compare, you know, the morphism and then all the, you know, this algebraic structure. And then, of course, maybe, I'm not sure on this side, but the farthest part here is to go from the topological to the actual, right? And then you have to prove some generation. That is far beyond my knowledge in those things. This is, I guess, the more difficult except for the curves. I'll start with some combinatorial object and I'll show you, you know, how to associate you know, the objects in both sides. And if I have enough time, I'll maybe give a couple of examples and computing them more. All right, so the starting point is we have a lattice M, and inside M we have a subset A, fine subset, and I also have a function called nu from A to the real number. And so that function defines for me a triangulation, generic, define a triangulation in the usual way. You just look at the, extend this function to this linear function on a convex hull plane and look from the upper convex hull, and its lower part is going to give the subdivision of the convex hull of A, triangulation. If it's a generic, then it's going to be a triangulation. So let's be called T. So the objects are going to be the polynomial data. So it's going to consist of two things. The objects. Going to be a pair, it's going to be tau. Tau is always going to be a simplex, so it's a simplex in T. And I also have for lambda, this is a function on vertices of the star of that simplex. So integral value, so okay, I'll say, so lambda is a function from the vertices of the star tau. And integers, but I want somehow, well, in general, that's okay, then it's two, yeah, it's going to be two integers, right? But I'm looking at the function module the affine linear, the linear part is an M, which is a rule for M.
What is star of tau?
Star of tau is all the simplices which contain tau. Any other questions? define modular global, you know, in integral affine function.
Sorry, and when you say vertices of star of tau, you mean all the extra vertices or including the vertices of tau?
Including the vertices of tau. It's not a limb of tau. That would be a limb if it's not including tau. But including the vertices, and the star is everything, including tau.
Can you draw it?
Yeah, I'll draw it. Don't worry. Okay, do you want to draw it? All right.
This is my the picture.
Example for today, at least to start with. This is my tau. Uh-huh. It's an interval, and the star of tau is everything which, you know, this big, you know, this triangle. Mm-hmm.
And so there are four vertices in this case.
There are four vertices in this case.
And if you take a triangle as tau, then what?
If you take a triangle?
If you take tau to be one of the triangles.
Well, it depends. Yeah, if it's a triangle, then this is, if it's a maximal complex, that's the only, you know, tau is its own star.
Ah, okay.
It's everything which contains tau. All right, anything else? Okay. More physics, you know? This is where I spent last night. So before I define morphism, I'm going to define a triangle, and this is so-called greasy polytope. I'm going to define it in my setting, so not the way they usually define. So greasy polytope is the following thing. So I have my lambda. So given lambda, given tau and lambda, I'm going to define that this is the polytope, which is the following thing. So it's a complex of vector spaces, and it's defined as follows. So for every sigma in a star of tau, so let me start with tau. So first I'm going to define it's called C Z tau. So this is lambda restricted to tau plus tau star. And I take the integral points there. So this is in a dual space. So tau lives in N, and that thing lives in MR. So this is a subset in N. So tau is the lambda restricted to tau is not going to find a point in M, but since I added the whole hyperplane, the whole subspace tau curve here, it is actually, this sum is actually well defined.
Is not defined as what?
This is going to be a vector subspace in MR, and I take the integral points. Tau is not defined, it's defined modular tau per. I mean, lambda restricted to tau defined modular tau per, but I add the whole tau per. So this is well defined hyperplane.
Why is it defined on the modular tau per?
Because lambda is defined like a point in M, but when I restrict lambda to just a tau, this is not really defined. I take my lambda only restricted to this tau, so I don't know, that other part is actually is exactly, this is well defined modular tau.
So you're twisting by this tau, that's what you're twisting.
I'm not twisting it. Twisted means different.
So is this ambiguity just because of the ambiguity in the
definition of lambda? Yeah, because lambda is actually is linear on tau, but it's not a global. I mean, we don't know.
Lambda is modular linear functions. No,
it's modular linear functions, modular M. Tau may, if tau is unimodular, then we can always take tau to be zero.
Okay, yeah, that's
okay.
So you're not using the full lambda, just lambda defining the
tau. One tau.
Where it's linear, and that's why it's meaningful.
Yeah. It's meaningful. And I'm going to also use a lambda defined on all other synthesis, but that's just later. So,
so what's the this thing about tau equal to zero?
So if tau is in the mini order, then we can always set lambda to be zero. Okay. This is C. Okay. And then for every sigma in the star. What I do, now I have my lambda defined on sigma, so now lambda restricted to sigma is again well defined, modular sigma curve, again, for the same reason. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take C, sigma Z, is going to be the same thing, but now I take lambda restricted to sigma, and I subtract the dual cone to sigma. Well, the right way to say it is sigma L tau. And I take all the integral points. So I'll give an example. And then my complex is going to be so this morphism.
What does sigma do?
It's a cone which is all the points which are. All right. If I take, so this is my tau. For instance, this is my sigma. So tau perp is tau perp is the integer of tau. And so this is my cone. Everything which is, wife and less.
So they may intersect and they may
intersect.
Join. Yeah. It depends on.
Maybe, it depends on if the function is. All right. So maybe I'll give a couple of examples. So the easiest example. This was introduced. I think the notion was introduced in the paper of. It's probably known. It's probably in the book of historic varieties. I haven't checked. So this is the concept which calculates the Czech homology of coherent sheaves on toric varieties. So the first one, the easiest example to understand is all right. And I didn't finish with my complex. So all right, my complex is going to be. So I start with my C to the power CZ tau. CZ tau. That's my tau. And here is my complex. So I have C CZ sigma. So this is the sum. Sigma is just one larger than the tau, superface of tau, and so forth. And the last one is the sum over the maximum. So maximum.
This computes the RAM. Is it the RAM? No, is the RAM complex.
Is it the RAM? I think it checks, so you just cover your toric variety by
the.
You have to check the homology of what?
Oh, okay. I'll give it to No. Oh, so lambda defined a invariant shape. Lambda defines for you a line. Yeah, line bundle. So lambda defines a line bundle, and that's the complex you should use to use the homology.
A line bundle on a closure of the toric orbit, or a line bundle of what? There is also tau. I mean.
I mod out my tau in some sense. So I don't care much about tau, I care about relative fan.
So it's a line bundle on the
toric variety of defined by the relative fan. So in this example this toric variety is PPP1, mm-hmm. And if I have two values here that defines for me that.
So does the toric variety depend on lambda?
The required does not depend on lambda. It's a line bundle which we have. So if the function lambda is convex, then this is the only place when it's when the only h0 is not zero, and h0 is the integral point of the dual polytope. So which is MA. Maybe I'll give an interesting example. So again, let me take tau to be a vertex, so then I have a fence. F1. So this is my toric variety, and lambda say is going to be. 1, 1, 0, 0. So this is not convex, you see. So instead of and now we have, so if you use this computation on the cohomology, then you see this picture. This is why it's the name is polytope. So it's here it's degree 0, so here it's h0 here, and here it's when you have h. All right, now the morphisms. So I have now two objects, sigma and tau. And zero unless.
Is it still an example or you are back to the general stuff?
I'm now defining a home between two options. I defined a twisted Puerto, it's a complex, and now my home is going to be this kind of complex. It's going to be actually sound complexes. I'm going to define it. Unless there's a syntax delta which is spanned by tau union sigma. So the typical example, if you have two vertices, if the end points of the one interval is the delta is going to be the interval and the tau and sigma going to be the vertex.
So I'm sorry. When you write delta equals tau union sigma, what does it mean? What is delta?
There is something, everything is every, okay, there is, so sigma.
Tau and sigma are synthesis.
Yeah, so if tau and sigma are faces of the same opposite. Okay. So delta is a minimal, so delta is minimal simplex, which contains both sigma and tau.
As for dimension one faces or?
No, it's a minimal one which contains both.
If there is one.
If there is one. If there is no one, then it's zero. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to now break my sigma, my delta, as a disjoint union. So I take tau prime.
So home is a simplex.
Home is a complex.
A complex.
Tau and sigma prime, so that tau is a subsimplex of tau, and sigma is a subsimplex of sigma prime simplex tau of sigma. So now I want my delta to be spanned purely. For instance, if I have a three-dimensional simplex here, and my tau is one face of it, this is tau. The other phase is sigma, then the way to span the simplex, I can take two vertices of one simplex, for instance, this is going to be tau prime, and this is going to be the sigma prime. This is one way to span it as a disjoint union. There are many ways.
And can you take tau prime to be equal to tau, and sigma prime to be
to
just
be a vertex, prime? Yeah. Every possible, it's a sum of all possible decompositions.
When you write less, you mean less weak?
Then I write what?
Less, you mean less weak.
It's not less, it's just called inject. This is rest. I don't know what it means, but this is the way to write the syntax to be a subset.
But it means preceding way. Yeah.
Anyway, so. Press X. Okay, so now you want to normalize your, normalize sigma, lambda, and mu. By normalizing, I mean add some linear functions, such that lambda normalized, so it means that there is some equivalent function lambda prime and equivalent function mu prime, which differ by some linear prime function. Not necessarily integral anymore, because I actually don't want it to be integral. So lambda minus mu prime is one half tau prime, I'll explain what it means, minus one half sigma prime. So this is an indicator function, it's going to have a value one half on tau prime, on vertices of tau prime, and this is the indicator function for sigma prime, because one way one half on vertices of sigma prime.
And zero.
And zero alpha. One delta. And whatever they are, outside delta they are. So you cannot control. And then you take the twisted polytope. Of the function, so it's associated with delta and the star of delta, function.
So do you think that delta is unimodular?
No.
Is it always possible to normalize it in this way?
Yeah. I don't care if it's integral anymore. I can normalize, so I can, yeah. It's actually a very good point, of course. Delta, and I take the difference, lambda prime. So let's first do the A side. Maybe I'll do the B side because it's easy. And let's do your base here. So B side, so on the B side, you have you put your A on a level 1 to the inside M plus Z. This is what you usually do, though. This is on Dowagin-Postman, Cori buffer, or mirror to the hyperbus. So you put your A here, and then you take the fan over it. So this is your A. And then it's a zero. So to find there's a plate variety.
Over the same triangulation?
Yeah, you have a triangulation here. Lambda is now, it has the sum of the values here, so it's just, you know, this the notion of sorry about E2. And but there is this irrelevant ideal, and so whenever you consider anything sorry for writing, you're going to do your parents, you're going to do the metrics for activation in this ring, but you always going to respect this degrading. So, and then this irrelevant ideal I, which is generated by all x equals sigma hat. So sigma is a call. So I take pick a cone and I take a product of all monomials which are not in that cone. This is, so for P2, so it's actually enough to take the maximal cone. So this is the maximal cone, this is not in that maximal cone, so it's X, Y, and Z. So this here is my ideal for the projective space. So this is the key ingredient to all this computations. So you have to take the resolution of this idea. I don't think I'll have time for that. So metric factorization. Okay. So now what's the metric factorization? So if you have sigma, if you have tau lambda, so what's the metric factorization I take? So I'm going to take. So I take R. It's going to be the R module. It's going to be the map between R modules, and the map is so I take the exterior power of R. Maybe that's all right. The exterior power sigma. U, where U is a vertex of tau. And the map is uniform, so, and I shift it by lambda. So you break it into even odd, and you know that it's actually, you know, map from even to odd and from odd to even. This is the metric. And it's to make it degree zero. W is of degree zero, so by the way, W has degree zero. This also has degree zero. For this, we want the degree of theta to be. What's his story? So what did you get to me? may not fit on a plane, but they don't, I mean, for curves here, you don't really care if it's a local thing or not. So he had a bunch of, so this is my A. And this is the triangulation. So, so he had two parameters. So one was R theta, so